These are opening stages of what will be a broad and concerted campaign.
We know there's some things we do not know.
The grave danger of Saddam Hussein and his terrorist allies turning weapons of mass destruction against us or our friends and allies.
And you can see the two towers, a huge explosion now raining debris on all of us. We better get out of the way!
Cruise missiles followed by the F-117 stealth bombers with so-called bunker-busting bombs.
Ladies and gentlemen, we got him.
Before going into the philosophy and ideology behind the war on terror, we first need a very brief overview of the events that preceded this war. By no means will this provide the totality and complexity of the situation, but the context will be crucial to understand the statements, or rather the falsity of statements, later on in the video. And I promise we will get to Lacan and Zizek. Now, without further ado, let's get into the video. In 1978, the Afghan Communist Party staged a coup against the sitting government. This coup was run by Communist Party leader Nur Mohammad Taraki. However, in 1979 he was killed by party members who disliked his regime. Because they had signed a treaty with Russia the year before, where Russia promised financial and military support, it followed that they invaded Afghanistan to re-establish a stable communist state. However, since we are struck in the middle of the Cold War, the United States could not just let the Russians, the communists, invade a country. They had to join in. So, starting from 1984 forward, the United States gave billions of dollars to a rebellion Muslim group that wanted to free Afghanistan. The group was called Mujahideen. It was not long before people from other countries wanted to join the battle against the Russians, so different groups joined the jihad. One group that joined called themselves Al-Qaeda, and was led by the now famous Osama bin Laden. In 1989, the Russians admitted defeat and withdrew from Afghanistan. All this chaos in the region gave others the opportunity to seize the moment. And in 1990, Iraq under Saddam Hussein invaded Kuwait to get hold of their oil supply, since everything in this world is about oil. This action was struck down immediately by the UN-authorized coalition forces led by the United States, since this was the heart of the oil imperium that the US and European countries like Britain had built. In 1991, Bin Laden begins to get notoriety as he himself, as well as others, start to see him as a force against the constant occupation by other countries. First Russia, now the West. And in 1998, terrorist groups linked to Al-Qaeda commit a terrorist attack on the World Trade Center. No, this is not my mouth being off, they really did bomb the World Trade Center in 1998. And even though the towers were largely unharmed, they promised that the next time they would go down. And in 2001, they unfortunately succeeded in their task. And from that moment on, the war on terror was born. America acted in the most understandable way, and again helped the rebels in Afghanistan, now called the Northern Alliance, to expel the Taliban forces from Afghanistan by providing weapons, money and air support. Within months, they destroy most of the Taliban forces in Afghanistan, and once again there is hope in the country. But then America decides to do something that nobody saw coming. In 2003, they pulled most of their forces from Afghanistan to go and invade Iraq. And this brings us to the topic of this video. For why did they invade Iraq? How could you just abandon one country that had just been destroyed and then suddenly invade another? Sure, there is a good reason, isn't there? Enter Donald Rumsfeld. In 2002, Rumsfeld was asked to respond to a question at a US Department of Defense news briefing regarding the lack of evidence for the weapons of mass destruction that Iraq supposedly had. In response, Rumsfeld stated the following. Reports that say that something hasn't happened are always interesting to me, because as we know, there are known knowns. There are things we know we know. We also know there are known unknowns. That is to say, we know there are some things we do not know. But there are also unknown unknowns. The ones we don't know, we don't know. And if one looks throughout the history of our country and other free countries, it is the latter category that tends to be the difficult one. Now, the known knowns are easy. The sky is blue, for example. We all know this to be true. Then there is known unknowns. For example, we know quantum mechanics works, but we do not know why. And we know we don't know this. And then there is the unknown unknowns, referring here to what if Saddam had weapons we don't even know that they have. Some weapons even more dangerous than the weapons of mass destruction. We would not even know that we don't know. And it is in this way Rumsfeld used fear as a method to convince people that they should invade Iraq. However, according to Zizek, Rumsfeld missed one important last combination. The unknown knowns. What about the fourth term, which I claim is the most interesting one? Not the known unknowns, but the unknown knowns. Things we know, but we don't even know that we know them. That is to say, this is ideology. Ideology is not so much our explicit thesis. Today, of course, we live in a hedonist, cynical era. Nobody is ready to fight for big causes. We, as it were, practice these beliefs. They are embodied in our knowledge, in the materials we use, and so on and so on. I think that is why he lost his job. Because he didn't know what he knows. Why did things in Iraq go wrong? Precisely because American politics was not aware of its unknown knowns, of the implicit ideological prejudices, presuppositions, which they were simply here. Not even you are aware of them, but they regulate your activity. Things like presuppositions about how everybody in the world likes American type of democracy. Presuppositions about how the people will react in Iraq and so on. Their ideology that the whole world wants the American way of democracy was the reason that Rumsfeld had to use fear to convince the nation that they had to invade Iraq. Now, in this case, it might be that he really did not know what he knows. But there are also examples in which they clearly knew what they were doing. Yet, they continued to use language in a way to conceal this knowledge. And this is called a lie. In the previous analysis, we could see the effect of language and the way we use it to communicate. Language may be a gift to us humans, but it can also be a very dangerous tool when it is used to convey an ideology. For Lacan, language is a gift as dangerous to humanity as the horse was to the Trojans. It offers itself to our use free of charge. But once we accept it, it colonizes us. The symbolic order emerges from a gift, an offering, that marks its content as neutral in order to pose as a gift. When a gift is offered, what matters is not its content, but the link between the giver and receiver, established when the receiver accepts the gift. Not only language, but all acts that belong to the symbolic are always signifying something. For example, the declaration of the war on terror is a very clear signification of the intent to go to war. And the firm tone and stature of people like Rumsfeld signify the power and force of the United States. However, this signification is not exclusive to direct signification through language or symbols, but can also be done by its opposite. That is, by not mentioning something, or even by concealing something. For example, when, in February 2003, Colin Powell addressed the United Nations Assembly in order to advocate the attack on Iraq, the US delegation asked for the large reproduction of Picasso's Guernica on the wall behind the speaker's podium to be covered with a different visual ornament. Although the official explanation was that Guernica did not provide the right visual background for the televised transmission of Powell's speech, it was clear to everyone that the US delegation was afraid of that Guernica, the painting that commemorates the catastrophic result of the German aerial bombing of the Spanish city during the Civil War, would give rise to the wrong kind of associations. If it were to serve as the background to Powell advocating the bombing of Iraq by the far superior US Air Force. We can see here what Lacan meant with the claim that repression and the return of the repressed are one and the same process. It is the very act of covering the painting that gives the viewer the association between the tragedy of the German bombing and the speech that advocated the bombing of Iraq. Now, if the painting was not covered, most people would not have noticed the painting or would not even have known what it was about. This reflexive twist pertains to communication as such. One should not forget to include in the content of an act of communication the act itself, since the meaning of each act of communication is also to reflexively assert that it is an act of communication. Now, both Rumsfeld and Powell acted on the information that there were weapons of mass destruction and that Saddam harbored terrorists in Iraq. But the UN Commissioner Hans Blix stated that there was no evidence of any of these weapons that the US was talking about. So how did they get this information? The answer? Torture. But what made a good Christian country decide that torture is a good idea? Especially when it's not even legal according to international legislation. It is here that we need to look at the relation between language and truth. Because sometimes the truth is not literal, but implied in our symbols. And when taking these symbols too literal, acting like we follow the rules, we could actually be breaking them in the face of truth. Okay, let me give you an example. You have heard that it was said, "You shall not commit adultery." But I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lust has already committed adultery with her in his heart. And maybe this is also the way to answer the standard Christian criticism that the Jews, by seeking ways of obeying God's commandments and prohibitions literally, while nonetheless retaining what they desire, in effect cheat him. This criticism is meaningful within the confines of the standard Christian attitude, where what matters is the spirit, not the letter. Where you are guilty if the desire was in your heart, even if you did not break any letter of the law by your deeds. When, in order not to break the injunction that no pigs should be raised on the Holy Land of Israel, pigs are raised today on plateaus 3 feet above the ground. The Christian interpretation would be, see how hypocritical the Jews are. The meaning of their God's command is clear. Simply do not raise pigs. And the Jews, in a profoundly hypocritical way, take the divine statement literally, focusing on the totally unimportant specification on the land of Israel, and thus find a way of violating the spirit of the injunction while keeping to its letter. Now, this criticism of the Christian on the Jew can be easily translated to a criticism of the way that the US implemented torture. For in the Geneva Convention, torture is illegal. So what reason did the US give to justify this torture? Well, in a memo from John Ashcroft, he stated that this international law should not apply to Al-Qaeda, since Al-Qaeda is not a nation state that signed the Geneva Convention. However, it is logical that they did not sign this, since they did not exist when the Geneva Convention was implemented. Now, there is also a problem with the term torture itself. Therefore, what you do is just give it a different name. So America called it enhanced interrogation techniques. And these techniques included attention grasp, wall standing, sleep deprivation, and of course, waterboarding. We can now see clearly the moral sin that they committed in legalizing torture. The Geneva Convention was maybe not written for Al-Qaeda, and maybe the torture techniques are not as brutal as some that we have seen in the Middle Ages. It is nonetheless torture. And therefore, the Christian would say, see how hypocritical the United States government is. The meaning of their international law is clear. Simply, do not torture. What is even more shocking is that they were even informed by their own intelligence services that torture does not even work. Especially not compared to the existing interrogation techniques that the FBI and CIA had developed by that time. Now the reason that torture does not work is simple. If you torture someone, you do not get the truth, you only get what you want to hear. They will tell you everything to make the torture stop. But that is not the truth. It is quite ironic in a pessimistic way that the United States used deceitful methods to be able to torture people for the truth, and all they got were more lies. Lies to support an ideology that cost thousands of lives. Now, what follows from this analysis is that we can safely assume that at every step of the way, the fear, the lies and the torture, that the people in power were at least partly aware of their actions. They used fear to start a war in Iraq that was unjustified, or at least not in line with the reasons they gave themselves. And by this time we know that the reasons that they gave back then were flawed, and that they even knew that they were flawed. Now, this is no statement of good or evil on the part of the actions of the United States. It is merely the facts that unraveled in the face of their ideology. The important question is not whether these actions were good or evil. No, let's go beyond the simplistic and relative notion of good and evil here. A psychoanalyst would be more interested in the question, why did they use this ideology in the first place? If it is not to end terrorism in Iraq, if it is not to bring peace and democracy, which they evidently did not do, then why did they do it? This is the question I will leave you with for now. I have some ideas, but I'm curious what you think is the reason for this fear, these lies, and the torture. Please let us know what you think in the comments below. For now, thank you for watching the video. I hope that something good happens to you, my fellow Homo sapien. And I hope to see you in the next one.